God's Day, honoring those ladies in our life. Ladies, I just pray that God continues to bless you, and you have blessed so many people, and a lot of people just don't understand the way that ladies can bless others. And I know I just want to say thank you to my wife and Teresa for what they did Friday night. We had some ladies here. They had a dessert night, and we raised, I don't know how much money, but well over $100 for teen camps for this coming up this summer, as they did their dessert night. They had a dessert night. And I'm just telling you, guys, too bad you didn't come do dishes with me, because it tasted really good. I'm just saying, it was very good. But, you know, I'm not sure if we understand that we all have one thing in common, and that is that we all have our moms to be thankful for. Our moms have brought a lot of wisdom into our lives, and they've shared some important insights into us to help us in our day-to-day. Your mom has probably told you things like, make sure you clean behind your ears. It's always good wisdom, right? And they tell you to watch how you spend your money, because money doesn't grow on trees. They give us practical information that we use. Even when I was a teenager, and I thought I knew everything and I had all the answers to life, and I didn't need my mom, I realized that mom still knew best. I would argue with my mom, but mothers have this way of ultimately ending any argument, any discussion about anything, and they say it, those wonderful words, because I said so. Because I said so. It's like, but, all right. You just have no discussion after that. But a mother's love is shared by giving us good and solid advice. Moms give us good counsel when they tell us not to put stuff in our mouths because we don't know where it's been. And they also tell us to make sure we wear clean underwear, because you never know when you're going to get an ass. So it's always good to listen to mom. But moms also do this. They give us that little bit of freedom to start venturing out and learn a little bit. Of course, then moms turn around and they say, well, be careful. If you break your leg, don't come crying to me. Right? It's, you know. And then you say you're going to do something. They're like, well, if everybody else is jumping on a cliff, off a cliff, would you jump too? You know, they give us that little bit of freedom. But the ladies in our lives are so incredibly precious. And I hate to be the bearer of bad news for ladies, but I truly think that ladies, you actually have a greater responsibility. You have a greater responsibility. Think about this. When a man messes up, it's expected. It's just a given, right? A man, it's just going to mess up. I know whenever I mess up, my wife, she just says, you're such a man. I'm like, I love it, you know. It's almost a get out of, you know, making everything right card. It's like, I can screw up anytime I want. And my wife just says, you're such a man. So, ladies, I just want you to understand that you can, you know, you have a greater responsibility and a higher standard because they look to you for wisdom, for advice, and for everything that we need. So everybody watches you. They watch your actions. Guys, again, we can screw up every day of the week, and it's expected. So, you know, we're just going to go ahead and just keep messing up. Amen, men? Hey, we can do that, man. That's all right. Now, we know that isn't necessarily true. Because men, we are called to have a higher standard from our lives. We're called to be the spiritual authorities in our household. But I know that if I put a nail into a wall with a wrench, and my wife looks at me and shakes her head and says, you're such a man, I know that it still works, because I still succeeded at my job. But for ladies, for many, many, many years, and more years to come, women have been the backbone of our homes, our churches, of our community. All throughout history, women have been the backbone of everything that's taken place. We all know some pretty incredible women. And not all of them have been mothers, but they have been incredible women. Good, godly women that have helped us along the way. Many of those women are, maybe they're no longer living, but we still remember because they were such a blessing to us in our life. When Paul was writing to Timothy, Paul wrote a very personal letter. And he wrote this personal letter because he wanted it to reflect a person's spiritual life. Paul wrote this letter, and he wanted everybody to understand the testimony of our actions. The things we do, maybe the things that we don't do. See, both speak volumes about our life. The things that we do and the things that we fail to do, both speak about our maturity in Christ. But in 2 Timothy, Paul is expressing to Timothy, and we need to pay special attention to this, it's his spiritual walk. Because everyone is seen by others. I don't know how many times I've said this, and I believe this to be true. We are all leaders in this world. People are watching you each and every day. So we have to make sure that certain heresies do not threaten the integrity of the church. The church is a reflection of God Himself, and the church must be guarded. As a part of his warnings, Paul reminded Timothy of two godly women that he had in his life. Just like today, we all have women around us to help us each and every day. The last 3 weeks, we have been talking about putting an emphasis on the fact that our actions do influence other people. Our actions influence those around us. See, it's not just about us. It's about what other people see in us. Because we're all sharing things of life. What are people seeing from us? And again, ladies, you have a huge influence on people around you. But do not allow your actions to point people to the idols of self or to worldly idols that are around us. Remember, everything that we do is not about us, but everything should point to our one true God. Turn with me, if you would, to 2 Timothy. And we're going to be there. We're going to talk about this passage where Paul is sharing with Timothy. And in this passage, we're going to see that Paul is thanking God. But Paul is at a place where he really has every excuse not to be thanking God at this point in his life. Things aren't going well for Paul here. Paul isn't where he'd like to be. Paul isn't where he around the people he would really want to be around. Because Paul, in this letter, is in a Roman prison. When he writes this letter, he is writing from this dungeon, and he's being treated like a common criminal. Those who were in the Christian faith at this time were hunted down, and they were persecuted for their belief. But Paul, he still understands that it's not about him. And everything that he does, even in the Roman prison, he still wants to give God the glory. It's not about what he's going through. It's not about what he's feeling. It's not about what he's experiencing. It's about bringing glory to God. Sometimes in our life, we tend to forget about this example from Paul. Because worldly thinking has a way of influencing us in our lives. When really, we should be concentrating and making sure we're focusing on giving glory to God above. 2 Timothy, it's a little bit halfway over the books of the New Testament. If you find Titus, you've gone too far, go back. But here, we're going to be starting in verse 3, and it should be up on your screen behind me. I thank God, whom I serve, as my ancestors did, with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith with which first lived in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice. And I am persuaded now lives in you also. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. So do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord or of me as prisoner. Rather, join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time. But it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. In this passage, Paul, there's two things on his mind that we can see. The first is that he's reflecting on his own life. His family had been faithful Jewish followers, and he had a clear conscience of this. It was good. He had learned from his parents, from his heritage, all the things that were good. He had a clear conscience of the legacy of his family. But Paul here is also thinking about Timothy. See, Paul thinks of Timothy almost as a son. And Timothy, most likely, he wasn't converted under Paul's discipleship, because in Acts 16, it talks about their first meeting when Paul first met Timothy. But Paul takes on Timothy as a mentor, and we can see that he had a great affection for him. When Paul first meets Timothy, Timothy signs up to join and proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ along with Paul. But Paul notices two important things in Timothy's life. And what I see is that it was obvious that to Paul that Timothy was living in his faith. And notice those words. Paul notices that Timothy is living in his faith. Timothy also had a heart to share what he believed, to share that faith that abided in him. Here's what we can notice from Timothy. Look at verse 5. It says, I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. Again, Timothy's mother Eunice and his grandmother Lois, they were Jewish women who were then became believers in Jesus. This great part about this passage is about the relationship. Do not forget or do not pass over the relationship aspect of the ancestry here. There was a tradition of Christianity passed down. We are called to share our faith and pass down this tradition with those around us. And if we do not do that, it has consequences. Not just consequences, it has eternal consequences. And this doesn't just apply if you have a son or daughter. It also applies to teach our nieces, our nephews, those children in our community, in our church, and those around us. We pass down our belief in Christ and teach all who will listen about who Jesus is and what he has done. Now, men, we are really good at passing down and teaching our children how to throw a football, how to field a ground ball, how to drive a car so that no one gets killed. We're even pretty good at passing down our tradition of rooting for the Denver Broncos. I know. But what about the truth that truly matters? Are we passing down the vital teachings of who Jesus Christ is? Because those teachings have eternal consequences. Lois and Eunice are heroes. They're heroes. They passed down their faith to Timothy, and Timothy went on to do great things for the church. And even though salvation can't be passed down from one person to another, the teachings of Christ can be passed down, and they can accept Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. And we pass that down to our children. God is pleased with Christian households. We all know the heartache of family members or friends who are walking outside of God's design. We all know what that feels like in our hearts and in our souls. But it does not have to be a blood relative that we're passing this down. Why? Because God says we are all brothers and sisters in Christ. We are all family. One of the most important steps in our lives as a Christian is for us to let our children and others see that our faith is real. There's a quote I want to read to you, and it's about faith. And this is what it says. It says, real faith is messy. Real faith is messy. It feels guilty after doing wrong. It worries about those who are sick. Faith is sometimes weak, and we forget to put God first in our lives. And real faith is far from perfect. But real faith always makes the effort to make things right. Oh, ouch and amen. Real faith always makes the effort to make things right. Faith understands that things don't always go our way, but we still try to make things right. And faith has an everlasting home in our hearts, and that is to be shared. If you have the King James Version of verse 5, it says that the faith that Eunice and Lois had, it dwelt in them, it lived in them, it abided in them. Their faith wasn't only for when things were good, only when things were going the way they wanted them. It dwelt in them all the time. Their faith was real. William MacDonald tells us that their faith was a permanent presence within them, and that true and good and permanent faith was passed down to Timothy. That's what Timothy learned. And because it was a true, permanent faith, Timothy himself picked up a permanent faith. So despite all the trials, all the troubles that Timothy had in his life, it all pointed right back to his faith. And he could stand strong. See, real faith is always lived out. When we fall short, when we miss the mark, faith always tries to make things right. We push aside self. We push aside our idols, the things that we want, and we trust in God. Just like Eunice and Lois, be a part of a third generation Christianity household. Just like Timothy was raised in, let the world see the power of Christ being lived out in your life. And if you live that life, others will see it. Ladies, you have a way of being a significant part of people's lives. Ladies, you can have a huge impact. Whether you have children or if you don't have children, whether you're a teenager, not there yet, you still have a way of having a huge impact in those people around you. Make sure you are grounded in the words of God. See, there's something in our world that I wish wasn't true, but I believe it to be true. And it is this. I think we are seeing more and more children being raised in homes without any godly influence. Many are being raised in a household with a watered-down faith. And a watered-down faith, in many ways, is even more damaging than someone who's not being raised in any faith at all. Because we can get comfortable in our idols. We can get comfortable in our ways. And if we get comfortable in something that is not true to God's Word, then we're leading people astray. And our children learn from us. When the storms come up in life, when we have those troubles, when bad things happen, we have a tendency to rely more on what we know and less on God's Word. But a real and true faith understands God's Word. I want to remind you again of verse 5. Timothy learned a genuine faith. That's what we're called to live. Timothy's father was a Greek man. And it's believed at the time when he received this letter, when Timothy received this letter, he was most likely deceased. So Timothy's spiritual mentors, the women in his life, those who were living out a genuine faith, see, Timothy grasped it. He took hold of it because he saw it being lived out. That is the faith that we are all called to live. A genuine faith, again, is one that we can count on when things go wrong in our life. A genuine faith can weather and ride out any storm. If you were here a few weeks ago, we need to thank God for those storms in our life, because God uses those storms in our life to get us back on track. Amen? He uses storms as a good thing. When trials and tribulations come in our life, praise God for those, because it can help us to put our focus back where it needs to be, on God's Word. But hear me today, church. There is no better tradition that you can pass on to your children than a real and true and genuine faith in Jesus Christ. I found it interesting. Last week we were talking about trust. We were talking about how we can trust, and how most people have this idea that we trust that we rely on ourselves more than we trust in God. But if you remember, if you were here last week, we talked about the number one way to help us to trust God more is to put God first in our life. Then this week I was reading a blog about to pass on some information, how to be a more godly woman. I thought this would be some good information for us on this day. Guess what the number one answer was for that? Put God first in your life. Men, guess what? We can learn from that lesson. Men, put God first in your life. Your wife, those people around you, will see you living out that good, genuine faith. Your children, your nieces, your nephews, your family, those around you, they will see you living that good, genuine faith, and it has eternal consequences. See, we have to understand to put God first. Matthew 6:33 tells us, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all of these things will be given to you as well. Do you think that it's important to put God first in your life? God's word says it over and over and over again. So the question would be, do the people around you see you putting God first? Do the people around you see you living out a genuine faith in Christ? Or do they see you having a fair weather faith that disappears when things go bad? See, we are called to be models for Christ and for His church. But ladies, again, I truly believe that you even have a greater power. You even have more of an influence on lives around you. So how will you use your influence? The goal, ladies, and what I pray for you today, is that just like Timothy, Paul encouraged Timothy to do this, and I pray for you, as it says in verse 6, to fan into flame the gift of God. God bless the ladies that are in our life. But I pray that we fan into flame the gift that you have been given by God. We should all have a desire for our fire for God to stay hot. Keep fanning those flames and fueling the fire, just like the song says, come on, baby, light my fire. Come on, light my fire. Right? Jesus, light my fire. Light my fire. One way to fuel the fire is to make sure that we're in church. We have to make sure that we are in God's house. Whenever we get out of the habit of attending church, we were talking about that Sunday school. If whenever we fail to be in church, we're cooling down our faith. And that is the exact opposite of what Paul is telling Timothy. But it plays right into the enemy's schemes. Live your life in a manner to stand against the enemy's schemes, as it says in Ephesians 6. We've all seen campfires. Y'all like campfires? I love campfires. But I actually like when the campfire starts to go out. And it starts to burn down. There's no more flame. You see the coals. You see the black. And then a breeze comes up, and the orange gets bigger. Or you blow on it, and it starts to get bigger. I love watching that. But one thing is true. If you don't give it more fuel or more oxygen, it will die. See, I've never met a person who I've ever had to tell, back off, you are too hot for Jesus. You are too on fire for the Lord. I've never met a person that I have ever, 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 ever had to tell that to. But I've seen a lot of people who need to make sure they're fueling the fire, or they're fanning, they need to fan the flames to keep that fire burning. And church, I'm not so naive to believe that Mother's Day is a great day for everyone. There's a lot of people who didn't have a great mother, didn't have a great father, didn't have a great home life. But hear me today. Jesus is greater than all those circumstances. He can help you overcome all those hurts, all those pains. You can be the one to launch this genuine faith if you just put God first. You can take steps like Eunice and Lois and be the hero to those around you. Because I know one thing, each day is a brand new day. And remember the passage from Isaiah which tells us this, forget the former things. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing, God tells him. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. Forget the former things. Real women, real faith, and a genuine faith for God. See, our takeaway today is this. Do not allow yesterday, your past, to define you as a person. Do not allow that. Give it all to God and let God determine your future. And He will make your path straight. Amen? Amen. I hope we believe that this day. As our praise band comes back to the front, my last challenge for you today, for the ladies that are here, see, God wants you to be zealous in your spiritual life. But I can see from verse 7 that God also wants us to be fearless. Verse 7 says this, for the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but it gives us power. It gives us love and self-discipline. Yes, we are called to have a healthy fear for our Lord, but God gives us the power. He gives us love. He gives us self-discipline if we just trust Him. If you look up fear in the Greek, it's called phobos. It's where we get that word phobia. But one interesting fact about phobos or fear is explained this way. Fear, don't miss this, fear is abnormal, fear is irrational, and fear is unwarranted. Since fear is abnormal, irrational, and unwarranted, maybe it's not supposed to be something in our life. Maybe fear is something we are supposed to get rid of. So instead of living in fear, trust in God. Psalm 56:3 tells us, when I am afraid, I put my trust in God. I put my trust in Him. We are not called to have a life of fear because we can see that it is abnormal. It's irrational, and fear is unwarranted. But keep the fire burning for God. And we do that by making sure that we are in God's Word, that we have a healthy prayer life, that we assemble in God's house, and we take all these things to put God first. Ladies, You're a blessing. Each and every one of you. You do not probably even realize or even fathom the lives that you ladies have touched. Understand that God has put you in a special place, ladies. And God wants to give you even more blessings. I would like to invite all the ladies to come to the front. And just come down. If you're able to, would all the ladies just come stand right? And ladies.